Yeah. I mean, it's been on my mind every day since we started this project.
I'm gonna have to get in front of a mirror.
Shame that he's missed out on this.
But anyway, this is, of course, now the horse ranch. So, this is my personal mare over here. She's so beautiful. This is Jewel, and I ride her. And I do a lot of work with the horses now, camping out and riding them. I had the original prints in the barn, and the waters rose and covered the barn. So that was messed up. But the good news is that we at least have the stills and the paperwork and the files from the business and the whole shoot that year.
We hit pay dirt, guys. Now here's all your
photos. My goodness.
Quite a pile of them. Yeah, this is an earlier investor writing in October of 77.
Robert Osborne, Hollywood Reporter. You know, all the early stuff.
Yeah.
New York Times.
Yeah, that's the Camby article.
Yeah, that's the Camby article. Here's a letter from Kim, and it's dated 77. Wow. 77.
This guy's an old friend of my father's.
Who's that?
Charlie Blumentritt.
Uh-huh.
He's sending a check for $100.
Look at this old. This is our original screenplay. No drums, no bugles. You remember? Here's the stills. Oh, look. This is a great shot of Eagle. I don't know if y'all have that.
We don't have anything.
Oh, you don't? You know, Texas is in my blood. That's my roots for seven generations. People who are not true Texans create cardboard characters. And you get, you know, Hollywood doing Hud and Giant or something like that. They're great movies, but they're not real about Texas. And that was the real forte of Eagle, that he had that insight.
I first heard of Eagle, it was right at that great moment in my own life where I was really fully discovering film. And I was just at that point interested in like, well, maybe I could make a film. I thought I could write a film. I love films, but had ideas, but I really wanted to go see this low budget local film. What the hell, you know, can you do around here? And it was magnificent. I mean, it was, looking back, it was a really big moment in my own film evolution, just because it gave me a lot of encouragement. Like, oh, here's the guy who around here with not much money made a movie that really spoke to me. Like, I knew those people just the way I know Eagle. You know, these are like people you grew up with, who you are yourself, you know.
Eagle, one of the things he did was he showed everybody around here that you don't have to just talk about it, you can actually do it. You can actually get a film made, because one thing that was that's always common is that there's 10,000 more people talk about it than do it. You know, compared to every one person that actually does it, there's 10,000 who talk about it. And Eagle was one of those people who carried through and really did it.
I encountered his work first. I saw the whole shooting match, probably around when it first came out, 79, 80, somewhere in there. And I just remember being totally charmed by it. I think there's a number of films that said to people, if you're talking about making a film, why don't you either go do it or shut up? You know, and I think Return of Skarka 7, which comes out, I think, 81, which is a sales film, does that. I think Slacker, which is 91, does that. And I think as much as any of them, Whole Shooting Match really does that.
It was way ahead of the curve. I mean, to this day, Redford, you know, credits that film with kind of waking him up, like, wow, there's film people everywhere. It's not just New York and L.A. There's talent all over this country. I want to do a film festival to support anything that could nurture all that talent out there.
WT.
A little difficult for me to talk.
Yeah.
I'm going through a little cancer here.
Ouch. He's got him a cancer. Let me put this water into the pot. I am the goddamn coffee king, Renee and Chuck. You probably don't know that.
So, let's go outside.
Lucky me. Man, lucky me. Blessing old Eagle Pennell. Was amazed to find out his name was Glenn. What? What's this Glenn shit?
Of course, you know, we are his parents, and we always call him Glenn.
Yeah. He got that nickname, Eagle.
He took that nickname
when he started in the movie business.
You know, the first idea we got that he was going to be a filmmaker, you know, he, out of nowhere, he made this little 30-minute short.
God damn it, Jimmy Lee, why don't you just let me ever get good and riled up? Why do you have to be so good-natured, you son of a bitch?
Well, I hadn't seen anything worth worrying about lately. You want to sit around here and bitch and moan all night, that's your business. I'm going out to the losers club and chase up some pussy.
Well, God damn it, wait a goddamn minute on me!
In 75 or 76, I was living in Austin and a singer in a band called the Uranium Savages.
Morning, lunch, about yet there, here
he is. Eagle Pennell came to see us. I had been told that he was in making films, and I told him that I would be interested. I was to get in a film. Sure enough, I don't know, within weeks or not too long after that, we shot this a hell of a note.
It's crude. Hell of a note is fucking crude. We literally had microphones up my britches leg.
None of that seemed to matter, though.
Right. Making a movie.
Oh, I thought it was great. This young man has some talent, I believe.
He had asked me to do the music for it, and I, you know, this would have been a hell of a note. This is pretty much my first professional experience of any kind.
You know, there's a Texas Film Festival, and Jim Blue down at Rice says, yeah, sure, bring it. And next thing we knew, we're down in Houston, and we're showing it at a film festival. And then pretty soon, Pat Taggart's calling me and Sonny a tumbleweed Hope and Crosby. Life was good.
Okay, so how did that get started? Did he contact you?
Or? Yeah, well, I'd made this film. You know, I'd been making spots, and I'd save a little money up, and I thought, well, I could make spots for the rest of my life. I thought I wanted to get into feature dramatic filmmaking. So I took $1,500 of my savings and made this film, a 30-minute film, which stars the two guys you'll see in the film tonight. Mm-hmm. So we finished it, you know, and I didn't know what would happen with it. I didn't know.
Did you have some idea how it distributing or something?
Well, you know, it's difficult to show shorts, you know. I sort of wanted to make it just to see if I could do it. And
did you show it in Austin?
Well, we had a private screening, but I didn't think anything would happen. Well, one day I got a call from James Blue, and he said, "Hello, Eagle. This is James Blue. We've heard about your film." I'm going, "What? How'd you hear?" He said, "We want to show it at Texpo this year. Would you come up? We'll pay your way up." And I said, "Sure." And so anyway, I came up, and there was a big crowd, and we showed the film, and they liked it. And I realized, well, hell, maybe I can do something, you know? So I went back to Austin, and I met some really talented people. One was the co-writer on the film, Lynn Sutherland.
This was after the Hell of a Note. Then you,
yeah.
You decided that you were going to make a...
I decided I was ready for a feature, you know, that...
Having made Concord 20 minutes, you were ready for a feature.
30 minutes.
30 minutes, right.
But, yeah, I figured I was ready for a feature. Well, hell, you have to try.
In the door. Doing my own documentaries, I've really come to realize that people's memories, actually, Lady Bird Johnson, when doing a documentary about her, she had this quote that, you know, the memory is a unfaithful servant, she would say. And it's true. And so what you have is not so much memory as impression of your memory.
And here we are. Pardon me for coughing in your ear.
Hey, how are you?
Breckenzie Texan, okay? Okay.
The milieu that Eagle Pennell came into in the 70s is in Austin was just perfect. What a great place and time. You could go hear great music for free or no more than $3. Dollar beer and $10 lids and free swimming, and it hadn't been discovered by the rest of the world.
We all found ourselves here right around 1970, just 69, 70 at the same time. We all woke up and went, whoa, far out.
You could go to Soap Creek, the Armadillo Beer Garden, Split Rail, and see everybody you needed to see.
Austin has always been like this oasis in the middle of the Texas cultural desert. But this is the place where everybody went for a drink of water.
I remember I was there when Willie Nelson first played the Armadillo. People were concerned because he brought a crowd that was country. The regular hippie crowd showed up at the Armadillo, and the country crowd showed up at the Armadillo, and they were kind of warily eyed each other for a while and decided that, you know, when the joint started getting past, that it was all going to be peaceful. And not only peaceful, but there was a new creature born then. It was that, you know, that redneck hippie thing.
When Willie leaves Nashville to come to Austin, it's a great moment in American cultural history. It really is, because it changes the rules. Before then, the model was, if you were gonna make it, you had to go to LA or New York.
Cactus Pryor, John Henry Falk, go back, Dobie, Benacek. This town has created international grade artists, writers, musicians that stayed local.
It was one of those revolutionary times like Dickens writes about Tale of Two Cities, you know, the best of times, worst of times. Well, it was the worst of times in the sense that we had an awful war going on, and all of us were in danger of being conscripted and sent away to be part of it ourselves, and a lot of us were sent away, conscripted, sent away, and died. But for me, I fondly remember just the best of times. Those days were great.
Thank you. What do you think, Tom? You want to take a break?
All right. Sounding good.
Thank you, Sonny.
Doug and I talked to you about our friends doing this little interview. You got a minute now?
It don't have to be true, does it?
No, in fact, they're hoping it's not.
So what brought you to Austin? I'll get these questions out of the way, and then I'll give you a lap dance, and we'll be out of here.
I think it was a station wagon. Or the trailer on the back. Yeah, well, you know, I've been coming here a long time. Yeah. And, of course, you know, even before I went to Nashville, I'd been playing around Austin and Dessau Hall and
right,
all the
right.
great
historical places.
Yeah, Round Rock, the Big G's at Round Rock. Yeah. And loved Austin, always yeah. have. And there was people like Graham Parsons and Commander Cody and a lot of these guys that, Jerry Jeff Walker, mm-hmm. Gary Pete Nunn, that had already got started in this area and they already had it rolling. And then when I got here, I said, well, you know, this is the way it's going. Mm-hmm. So I saw a parade and jumped in front.
Yeah. What was that thing about the nuns on bicycles?
There was two nuns on a bicycle, and one of them, they was riding around the Vatican courtyard, and one of them said, you know, I don't think I've ever come this way before. And the other one said, me neither, it must be the cobblestones.
You look so much like Eagle. I look at you and I think, well, if Eagle had lived, you're a good bit shorter than he was, aren't you? But yeah. Well,
I did the best I could.
Well, but we came to Austin in 74. And one Sunday morning, my husband was reading the newspaper and he said, oh, look, there's going to be an audition for a movie. And I'd never been in a film. You know, I grew up in the theater. So I got the paper and I started reading the roles, and it said, Paulette, a good old girl, a former beauty, or something like that. And I read the other roles and I said, well, I hope that Paulette role's a good one, because that one sounds like me.
I was sitting on a bar stool listening to Delbert McClinton at Soap Creek Saloon for $2. He walked up and said, I hear you're a writer. And I said, yeah, you know, I've written things. Who the hell are you?
I've been working in there with the sheetrock, and I've probably got sheetrock in my hair.
He said, I want you to help me make a film. He said, and he introduced me to Lynn. And from that point on, it was, how do we raise the money?
After we finished the script and I read it, I said, this is good. I want to do it. And I was willing to try to raise money, which I'd never done before, and say, give me money for my my creative work.
I think I had a couple of friends that kicked in $500, which was a big investment for us. You know, but most of it was hook and crook.
I was approached to make props and given enough money to buy the materials. That was it, and everybody worked free. And just for the fun of doing it.
This is an electric eraser.
And he just held this up like this and spun it. After he put it in the soap, and that's when the bubble came out.
I, like most of the rest of the crew, had a day job. So the filmmaking limited itself to the weekends.
We'd work some on Friday nights, work all day Saturday, all nights, you know, just straight through. And I can remember, finally, Eagle would give Lynn $5 or something and say, go get us food.
We all did 500 things, you know, right. Ran around dawn to dusk, 18-hour days.
But the crew, I mean, I was moving stands. I mean, you know, we'd get there and we'd unload the stuff and set it up and boom, here, you know, okay, let's do it here, let's shoot it.
But it was mainly, you know, it was just a few of us.
Wayne with a mic, and Doug Holloway was, you know, maybe gaffing it somehow or something. And behind the camera would be Eagle.
He would just say, all right, put a light up there. And put a light up there, and I just take, you know, the gaffer's tape and tape those things to the wall. And that was pretty much our lighting.
They lit it, and, you know, and we did it. You know, we ran through it once, and then we said, fine, let's try one. And we shot it, and Eagle said, great, just got it, you know. Sonny and I look at each other. And that's when we start calling ourselves the One Take Kings. So that we're hot. We're the hottest thing that's walking in Texas. And then years later, I found out that that's all the film he had. He just had one role.
Morning, ma'am. Lloyd and Frank's Light Hauling. I'm Lloyd. This is my partner, Frank.
But what was going on during the week is these rehearsal sessions, and I attended, you know, dropped in on one or two of them.
We'd jam on these ideas about, okay, we're driving, we got a 10-minute drive, let's fill it up with dialogue or some kind of scheme.
Now, this is a real good one, Lloyd. You want me to get in a business I can't even pronounce the name, Polly What to Doodle All Day? I mean, this is like the chinchilla business, Lloyd. How much do we lose on that one, huh? That was our program.
Oh, air conditioners.
I should be driving a chinchilla Cadillac by now. How about the ball?
Since I wasn't as set in stone as the two leads, I was having to find those things that I thought would make up Olin. Because it was organic, I was able to experiment, try this and try that, and the things that he kept are the things that he liked.
Paula, I'll take care of Frank.
I don't think you guys.
Those rehearsals really paid off because we would get to the set and start to shoot something, and magic would happen.
It was exciting, and it was just the only thing in. You know, you're thinking about all week, and you couldn't wait to get out there Saturday and get, you know, get our hats on and go play act.
Look, old Dave. Look at him.
Oh, my goodness.
She's going to get it tonight.
Hey, boy!
Frank, stop it. What are you doing, Jerry? I'm going to go home. I swear you don't even know how to act. Act like you're drunk already.
I ain't drunk already. You're the one so giddy on one beer. You've been jiggling up like a little schoolgirl or something.
I don't have much beer I drink.
The script was really just a blueprint. I mean, I think it was important because it had the story and the characters and, you know, the basic essence of what the shoot match is about. But Sonny and Lou and Doris and Eric, they added so much to it.
I mean, you know, I can improv. Till I'd fall over, and we have to call the EMS, you know, go, oh, she died. But, I mean, I can just, you know, I don't have any difficulty talking. But Eagle had a sense of it, you know. There was a way that, you know, he made room for us to carry on, and he knew how to contain it.
He not only was creative and a good director and could see that whole storyline in his mind, he really could see that. But he also was a great inspirer. You know, he could really, in that sense, he was a good leader.
Eagle could have gotten a lot of different people to do his scores for him. But, you know, for some reason he gave the job to me. And I mean, I don't think he just, you know, wanted to help his little brother out. He had never wanted to help me out before, you know. I think he thought I had something something to offer that was maybe a little different.
I have known for years that I am prouder of the whole shooting match than anything I ever did. You don't have a trailer. You don't have craft services. You don't have overtime pay. If you stay up late shooting a scene, you gotta be at work tomorrow. But it's where the growth is happening. It's where the molecular changes occur. Really, evolution. I would say evolution. It's where you evolve into something else. And it begins to get in you that you can do this.
Get your hat there, Parker.
I'm just wandering around the wasteland, thinking about my cowboy days gone by.
Down at the Horseshoe Lounge, shuffleboard out neon light. Down at the Horseshoe Lounge, cigarette sound, whiskey tonight.
said she's out of your league, let her go. As I watched you pick your partner on that old dance floor, raising up my bottle, I looked for a chance. As you set your glass down on the bar, and glance at me down at the horseshoe lounge, shuffleboard out in the light, down at the horseshoe lounge. Just one more and I'll be alright. Ricky got the quarters for the table and broke, while I pulled hard on the sorrow and smoke.
Well, this is my big garden here. Got a few ripe ones, and I picked them this morning. Yeah, that's ready to go. Ought to be pretty good eating there for a little while. Well, when I was born, I was born in Midland, Texas. But Dad was a rancher out in Andrews. He came when he was about 18 years old. He was born in West Virginia. And at that time, you could file on property and live on it, and it became yours. And he started ranching for himself there. And of course, that was about the time that he and Mother got married.
My grandfather was stalwart and able cowboys ever saddled a horse, and our grandmother Jessie was his equal in every way. And then they had those four strapping sons, all broad shoulder, square jaw, tough hombres, you know, men you'd step aside for on the sidewalk, and they were all true Westerners in the best sense of the word. And they were strong, they were gentle. Eagle felt this, you know, pull to the Pennell side and the ranches, and you know, there was some quality in about both the people and the landscape that really, really spoke to him. Look at the characters in his film, and you look at the characters that peopled his childhood out there, and they're very much the same. Those ranches are all completely disappeared now,
I guess. Oh yeah, yeah, they have. It. No, in fact, the you can't even tell now where our old ranch used to be. The last time I was out there, I couldn't even find it.
I never knew the Eagle stuff, obviously. I never knew he was a filmmaker. You know, we called him E.
The Big E. He had 156 field goals, 86 free throws, for total points of 398. That led the team. You know, we couldn't have done it without him.
When he was playing basketball in high school, he was the dominant player on the team and caught the whole school's attention and the whole town to some extent.
Every time he made a basket or a score on one of those shots, everybody would yell, "Ee! Ee! Ee!" The whole auditorium.
Had a beautiful jump shot. It's just a thing of beauty.
He'd kind of back his man up, and he'd pivot a little pivot to the left, and then he'd turn to the right, and he'd fall away. And it just smooth as peanut butter. And and he'd hit it every time.
That's where I first saw him kind of come into his own in terms of that power that he had to control people and lead them on journeys. But when he left for Austin in 1970, nobody in his family had any clue that he would become a great filmmaker.
And now, along with our selecting critic, Art Knight, it's a great pleasure for us to present to you almost the whole shooting match, director Eagle Pennell, and the three leads, Sonny Davis, Lou Perry, and Doris Hargrave. Welcome.
I'd like to just say something to the audience, if I may, before going to the formal part of the interview. Because what happened with this film is something that I feel is very important, and it's a phenomenon that's just beginning to happen. We're so used to movies coming either from Hollywood or from New York that we forget that there's a great section of the country still to be heard from. That's the way I received the whole shooting match. It seemed to me that here was a story that was recognizably Texas, recognizably Texans, and that they were able to tell us something about a way of life that for those of us who live in various parts of the country would be of far more interest than if it was told to us by somebody who discovered Texas out of American International. And that is why I was so eager to have the film receive its premiere here in Dallas. And Eagle, I can only congratulate you for what you've done.
That's very kind. I was very fortunate that, to find a group of very talented people who were willing to work for nothing for the chance to do a picture. You know, there's $15,000 in cash in the picture, and there's about $1 million worth of talent, I think, in terms of the people who work with them. Everybody I think was just looking for that break, a chance to do something they've never been able to get. The hell of this system, this film business we have in this country is very closed. When I was growing up, I wanted to be a filmmaker, but I thought it was a ridiculous dream because those films were made out there in Hollywood, you know, and you have to have a golden key to get in. You know, well, that's not true, I don't think. And I know this film, you say it's regional, I agree with that. But I made the film hoping that it's played to a national audience. I hope there are things in the film that, you know, appeal to people from all over.
When you think about it, they made the film in late 1977, and by, I believe it was March of 78, it was already showing at the USA Film Festival in Dallas, which was a very big, very well-respected festival at that time. And that's really where it got its first public notice. There was a person serving as a judge at that festival, a columnist for The Hollywood Reporter named Arthur Knight.
Arthur Knight, there you go. Hmm. Arthur Knight from Hollywood Reporter. You know, it was like, well, and Eagle said he liked it. Ah, no shit.
The whole shooting match just blew him away. He devoted nearly his entire column that he wrote to go by wire to the Hollywood Reporter to shooting match. And he said something like, the film's regionality will transcend, you know, Texas, and this has the ability to appeal to a nationwide audience.
Yeah, I drug that review around for years. I thought I was properly impressed that he liked us all so much, yeah.
And from that, it was chosen to play at the U.S. Film Festival in September of 78. The U.S. Film Festival later became the Sundance Film Festival.
Eagle called, come over, we got accepted to a film festival. I went over there and he comes running, I think he's coming from the next next door neighbors because he didn't have a telephone, I don't think. But I came running and said, we got accepted, man. We got accepted to the U.S. Film Festival, USA Film Festival in Utah. And I go, gives me a big old bear hug, and I'm going, what is that?
So how did you meet my uncle?
I met Eagle at the U.S. Film Festival in like 1980 in Salt Lake City. He was one of the finalists. He was premiering his film there, and I was premiering with Pennell, and I was premiering Property. We all went to dinner and had a great time, and it was kindred spirits from there forward.
When the U.S. Film Festival in Park City started, Robert Redford lived there, but he didn't have anything to do with the festival, and he went down to the Egyptian on the north end of town and was sitting there watching Eagle's film, Whole Shoot and Match, and had this epiphany. You know, it's exactly this kind of guy who needs to have a festival like this devoted to them.
You know, he really talked about that film as sort of the inspiration, not just for the kinds of films he wanted to have at the festival, but for what would later become the Sundance Lab.
You know, I have such mixed feelings about it, going back. Because it was just, you know, the highlight, highlight time, and at the same time, it was just a lot of really difficult relationships with Eagle. He could really get people inspired. And that worked until right. He abused them too much. And then they would, like, they were still inspired and wanted to work with him, but common sense said no, and that's what happened to me, you know. And I just, common sense said it's not going to be a win-win situation, so...
You guys don't mind if I return the favor, do you? Eagle, as a result of the attention that Whole Shoot and Match got, he really had opportunities in L.A. He got a deal to do a spec script for minimal money, and I was supposed to collaborate with him on it, and it just wound up being, you know, one crazed party, you know, go out and be crazy and spend the money.
It was a lot of cocaine, and it was the worst place for him to fall into. I mean, it was everywhere, and he was up to his neck in it, and he was a tall fella.
You know, I'm sure that probably was his downfall with Universal. They probably finally got fed up with him.
Yeah, I got in a fight with Eagle.
What was that about?
I believe at that point that was Eagle attempting to regroup his, bring his friends back together and be their leader again, and it was slipping away from him. And he held forth at the end of this rap party about how we were a group, and I took offense, and he invited me to fight, and he shoved me a couple times, and I popped him.
There was a sense that he was always on the verge of making a really, really big breakthrough with all the people that he was associating with, and they were interested in him, and interested in his movies, and but, you know, along with that kind of exciting talk would be really serious drinking and ego problem. You know, a darker side of him would emerge always, every time we were together at some point.
So if you were Eric Edwards, how would you shoot this?
Well, like I'm doing now.
Hey, Lou. How's it going, man? We're just sitting here chilling and wondering if you want to come by. We'd love to see you. Chilling, that's new school for hanging out.
God damn it!
You took the vowel out of G-O-T.
It was just like, God damn it. God damn it. Yeah. God damn it.
Kim Hinkle and Lee Perry called me to do Last Night at the Alamo in Houston. And I said, yeah, I'm in. You know, Kim, are you directing? He said, no, Eagle's directing. And there was a pause on the phone because I'm thinking about, okay. If, you know, when was the last time I told him to fuck off?
Last Night at the Alamo was my memory of the actual making of the film, which took place in mostly May, June of 82. It was great.
Eagle at his best on the set, I think, was taking a script that was unfinished and overwritten and cutting right through to the bone of a scene. You know, he had a good facility for that.
We would arrive at the bar at about, 8 o'clock in the morning, 7:30 or 8 o'clock, all of us. It was an intense, real film experience. Rather than always having to follow the orders of somebody else, I got to offer up an idea. Say, well, I want to shoot it like this. I want to shoot it as a long take, you know, we'll do a dolly, blah, 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 you know, like that. And then he would say, okay, we'll do that. Or he would say, no. Okay, you can have half of that, and then we'll do blah, 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 like that. But it was, but these things were made, you know, just in those moments.
At worst, he would show up on the set drunk.
I'm kind of interested in the fact that you guys had not a very good creative experience on that first Universal gig. I'm curious as to how he got you convinced to work with him again.
There was an opportunity to be a part of something, you know, that was quite special at that time. There weren't people making films all over the place.
I think at that time, come to think of it, I didn't have a full understanding of the degree to which, you know, Eagle was governed by his appetites.
That was a hard shoot in a lot of ways. Eagle was starting to get in real trouble with
his demons.
The touch of the stuff. His demons, yeah, his demons.
Yeah. Oh, man, remember that woman that Eagle married?
He would do these stupid things.
I think I had to witness it. And he, you know, he had to put a ring on her, and it was like, it was all very clandestine and drunken.
He couldn't, you know, preach her justice of the peace. He thought a ship captain could marry him. Well, at sea they can, not in docked Houston ship channel.
And as the story went, her parents decided to have a party at a rather fashionable Houston locale. To celebrate the marriage, and his wife had a sister who was quite cute, and while I was standing there with them, Eagle had his hands on his wife's sister. This is his wedding party, you know, and he's groping this woman and demanding that she suck his cock, and I'm taking still photographs while this is happening. And of it, you can see her in the photographs kind of ricocheting back away from this guy, you know, and he was just out of control. By the end of the evening, he had to flee the restaurant. All the waiters, you know, his wife is crying, is in tears, and all the waiters of this place, as I recall, they're all Mexican-American, are coming after him, and so Eagle is backing away from them, and they're all coming in around him. And he stops suddenly and turns and confronts them and then recites Sam Houston's speech prior to the attack of the Battle of San Jacinto, which the words quite short. The words are something along the lines of, gentlemen, trust in God and fear not, and remember the Alamo. And all these waiters stop dead in their tracks. I kid you not, I was standing there. They stopped dead in their tracks. And in their moment of hesitation, he turned and fled into the night.
I never really knew Glenn. I didn't know he was even a filmmaker until he passed away, really. My dad told me about it, but I never saw any of his movies. Yeah. I'm just curious, like, what point did you notice that his alcohol and his drinking started to get in the way of his life, you know, and to sort of dominate? Because it seems like he didn't always have such a problem.
He recognized that he had a problem. In fact, he wrote and said, "I've got to do something," and we helped him get into a alcoholic. What do you call it?
Rehabilitation.
Rehabilitation, something like that. And he was in that for.
He'd go in 2 or 3 different times, but last one, the one that stayed in the longest, we'd really hoped
that maybe he might make a change. And when he first came out, we thought, well, boy, it has done good, but
he was really trying.
It just didn't last, unfortunately.
He showed up in Austin. And he was, it was like 3 in the afternoon, he was drunk as a skunk. He tried to open the driver's door and told me to move over. And I said, I don't think that's a good idea. So then he goes, okay. So he got in the back and with his sunglasses on and I drove him around. We drove into the hill country and he was looking for a Mongolian barbecue place that it was someplace he'd been in his youth. And we finally found this thing. We were driving around now for hours. He's drinking. We go into the restaurant and the polite Korean man tells us he can't accept credit cards, so Eagle gives him a whole long story about this is his lost youth, he's trying to recover. The man finally says, "You just send me the money." So the first thing Eagle does is ask for the wine list and order 3 bottles of champagne. We have a huge dinner. I'm now 3 sheets to the wind. I am not capable of keeping up with this man. We used to say he was the man was a real alcoholic. He put pop alcoholics like us to shame. He every night of his life was like this with someone. And I remember on the way out of the restaurant, him crumpling up the receipt and throwing it in the parking lot. And that was the beginning of our first adventure. We went down to 6th Street. He was buying plates of oysters, dozen oysters at a time. He was buying drinks. People would come along with us. He would flag him in. He got too drunk to sign the credit card carbon, so he was having me sign him. At some point, I have his credit card. It's his wife's credit card. And he says, "I'm surprised you can even hang on to that. It's so hot." Turns out he was separated from his wife, but somehow she had not canceled the credit cards yet. Oh, I had all sorts of adventures with him. I was in Texas once to see something at the film center. I called him up and wound up taking a date to like meet him at a bar. And then at the end of the evening, he'd talk the girl who came with me into going home and going to bed with him, and I never saw her again. It would be like that, you know. I'd take him to the airport, and he would be walking into the concourse, and he would try to get his plane ticket out, and he would drop a full quart of scotch, J&B scotch, and it would explode on the pavement, and he would just kind of like, just with a practiced air, just kind of avoid it and go on in. He was like, Sid Vicious walking through the plate glass window in slow motion and Sid and Nancy. His life was just like that, except somehow he wouldn't get hurt by it.
He could have used you in those later years.
Yeah, he...
I can't blame you for not working with him, but boy, he was a man in search of a good script and a good story his latter days.
You know, when he talked me that story about the King of Texas, I was sorely tempted.
What is that story?
It's a Texas version of King Lear. Of course, it was a great idea. You know, Eagle had tons of good ideas. He was a really great idea person. And he was a great director. It was just that his life got in the way of completion of things and his weaknesses and his fatal flaw. I mean, he had a fatal flaw, and that was addiction.
Oh, man. You know, Eagle had mentioned this idea called the King of Texas to Michael Schamburg. Well, the King of Texas is a nice title, and you know he had a few really vague ideas that you know elicited some interest, but there was nothing else. There was no story. There was nothing there. So they brought us out to L.A.
and put us up in the at the Marriott. So I do all the talking and just kind of blather on about this scene, which is about these two guys encountering a third guy and lassoing a rattlesnake. I don't think Eagle had any idea that absent some sort of story that we could present to them, you know, nothing would have ever happened. He just seemed to think it was a foregone conclusion that they're going to hand over a deal to you. This, no real touchstone with the reality there.
I remember several times where he would just kind of be in tears about how, you know, he had messed his life up and hurt so many people, and, you know, wish he could be better, and yada, you know, yada yada, and would be kind of sobbing and you know, snot all on his mustache, and then the next day he'd be Eagle.
I was pleased to find out that he was interested in making a Western, a traditional Western. One of the reasons that we spent bits of time together was that we did share this kind of love of the frontier traditions, you know, the movies of John Ford, all that stuff, you know. Anyway, he wanted to make a Western. I thought, God damn it, it's about time. I agree, we can make a Western, you know, we can make a small Western. It doesn't have to have a lot of horses and crap in it, you know. We can go down to Brackettville, where John Wayne's location is. I knew Happy Shahan somewhat, who's the owner of the place, and he could be flexible. We could do a little Eagle-sized film there, and it would be fun, and it would be something different.
Corolla.
Come to point every man's life when necessary, take a stand or a leap.
And a script came out of that, which does exist, and it's called Santa Ana's Gold. All I can tell you is the opening scene is this guy wandering through the chaparral of South Texas, encountering this gigantic longhorn, wild longhorn steer in the brush, and that's how the... That's how it begins. I have no recollection of where the story goes after that. Obviously, it was never made. The film that was finally made was Heart Full of Soul.
I'm Clevedore Linedecker.
Nathan Hanna, but folks around these parts call me Bubba.
Oh, Bubba, huh? Bubba. Well, I got a confession to make. People around these parts call me... Pee-wee,
huh?
Yeah.
Well, where are you going after Hempstead?
I'm going to San Antone.
San Antone, huh?
Yeah. You ever watched Jeopardy?
Jeopardy?
Jeopardy.
Yeah, I've seen it a couple times.
Well, my mother and I watch it all the time.
Oh, really?
All the time, yeah. In fact, we have a little ritual, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, before she watches it, she has me mix her this little eensy teensy little Black Label Jack Daniels drinky poop. You know what I mean? I give it to her. And then I go to the kitchen and mix myself a great big tall glass of vodka, put some ice cubes in it, and call it ice water. You know what I mean? And she has her little drinky poos, and I have my ice water and my Jeopardy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Listen, I'm going to be on it, so.
So when's your next interview?
Well, I see the picture.
I mean, your next picture.
I just directed a little low-budget feature in Houston this summer,
yeah.
Called Heart Full of Soul, and just now started to edit it, so it's going to be a while before it's finished.
What's it about?
It's about a guy from Houston, or a guy's kind of a two glasses of champagne. guys been living in Houston for a long time, and he gets kind of tired of it and goes back to the small town in Texas where he's originally from after being gone for a long time. And kind of about what it's like to go back after. After being gone for a while.
I'm holding the
bag.
Can you go?
Yeah.
In the summer of 1990, we did a panel at the Munich Film Festival. So Eagle and I got to go on, and he kind of was like, he could be very jovial at times, then he could kind of, maybe wasn't looking forward to the Q&A or whatever, he just kind of, any questions? And then, like, one hand goes up, like, you know, it's like, well, why'd you shoot in black and white? I think he's like, well, it's my favorite color. Any more questions? And then he kind of daring the audience to ask the next question, and no one did, you know, these polite Europeans. Any more questions? Well, I'll see you at the bar. And then walks out. That was like a one. But that's memorable. You could, you know, people jaw on for an hour and, you know, just you walk out of the theater and you've forgotten it. But, you know, just one succinct, it's my favorite color. I'll never forget it.
You know, this larger-than-life version of himself was, you know, that was him. That was his art. That was his thing. He was, every filmmaker is that, but not as much. Every filmmaker starts a film without all of his financing. It imagines he'll get distribution, pretends if he gets some momentum going that people won't be able to stop him. He just did that as a matter of course. That was his life. He got to, dinner was like that for him, you know? Crossing town was like that for him. The wide swath of people that he powered through and that were all left in his wake were that for him.
It's a New Year's Day, just like the day before. Same old skies of gray, same empty bottles on the floor. Another year gone by, and I'm thinking once again, how can I take this losing hand and somehow win? Give me one good year to get my feet back on the ground. I've been chasing grace, but grace ain't so easily found. One bad hill can devil a man, chase him and carry him down. I gotta get out of here, just give me one good year. I gotta get out of here, just give me one good year.
When he was sober, he liked to go out and explore things and see things. We'd maybe ride down to Galveston, walk on the beach. We would go to museums. That's when he was sober. When he was drunk, he just went looking for the next bar. When he was drinking, he was very disrespectful, very hateful. Very hateful. I talked to him when he was sober one time. I said, why do you say all these nasty things and mean things to me, okay? He said, you don't understand, Liz, it's me. I don't like. And once he said that, I came to an understanding that when he was doing that, he was getting rid of his feeling of inadequacies within himself.
I remember Doc's Full Service, I wrote a review of, and I knew Eagle well enough at that point that I was a little bit freaked because I didn't like it. I mean, I said basically that it looked like a really promising first film, which was a problem with Eagle in that a lot of his films looked like a really promising first film, even though it was his third or fourth film. And I was nervous about seeing Eagle because, you know, you don't like to run into a filmmaker when you said that. But Eagle being Eagle, when I saw him, he started crying and told me I was right.
I don't think I ever saw it. It was one called Doc's Full Service or something like that. I think that might have been it. I just got him left.
Well, you mean when you saw it?
Yeah,
Oh, you didn't like it?
You know, Sonny and me gave him hell, and, you know, so he replaced us.
I guess the best projects were a product of him working with other people. So that somebody like a Lynn Sutherland deserves a huge amount of credit for the film Whole Shooting Match. Without Kim Hinkle, Last Night at the Alamo would have been God knows where. When we get to Heart Full of Soul, there was nobody there. There was initially, and then that person withdrew, and then that film isn't very interesting. And the same thing with Doc's Full Service. I mean, whatever the spark was that had encouraged him to make films initially was pretty much out.
I don't even know why I condescend to drink with him.
Well, don't mind me. Just make yourself at home.
Doing you a favor, Doc. I know you don't like to drink alone.
Mm-hmm. Just, you know, a little bit.
He'd get up in the morning and he'd be sick as a dog. Sick, really sick. Which is, I mean, more than just sick, more than a hangover. And he'd have to go have a drink to get through that.
I was around him all through those last years, and he'd be in and out of rehab. And Elizabeth Knox, she just put up with all this crap. And one day, the moving trucks arrived, took her stuff away, and her with them to her new place. And Eagle was on the street. It's like a light switch. He went from, you know, high living, the fancy, you know, $1,500 a month condo on Montrose to, like, under the bridge alcoholic. You know, sometimes he would turn up at my office, one time in particular, I remember, and he'd been beaten black and blue. Clearly, someone had beaten the shit out of him. You know, he had a black eye. And I tried to get him to explain what had happened, but he just kind of grinned at me.
At a certain point, the delusions of grandeur went away. He knew he wasn't going to straighten out and revive his career. He was resigned to his course, which was basically he was drinking himself to death, you know, and he was conscious of that at a certain point, conscious and resigned to it, and that's what it is.
Towards the last, I imagine there was lots of people that would tell him not to come around.
We never told him that. We never told him that he was not to come, but we would not, there's just so much we could do for him, and then the rest of it he had to do on his own.
He was afraid of getting old. He hated his 40th birthday, hated it. Said, I don't want to ever be 50. And he didn't.
The last time I saw him was just a few weeks before he died, and the typical Eagle, you know, he came pounding on the door at midnight. But I was so mad at him, I just, you know, I couldn't take him in. You know, I sent him away. My last vision of him, you know, was him walking off down the hill. And, you know, about a month later, he died. And this is where he lies, this is where he rests.
wanted to try. I think he really wanted to do it. I just think he couldn't.
He just couldn't, apparently.
I don't know why. It was a...
The night we buried him, I dreamed that Eagle had come back, and he was, you know, I came home and he was in my shower trying to wash the mortician's makeup off his face, and the whole house, you know, smelled like death, and I had to face him, you know, and get him out of the shower, and I told him, Eagle, I'm sorry, but you're dead. You can't come back. Didn't want to accept that, you know, and was crying. You know, I don't know what he wanted. He had kind of burned all of his bridges at that point, you know, with his family and all of his old friends that had stuck by him. Yeah. Sorry, bro.
Well, I knew a guy had lived in a little bitty place. He could sit on the commode and open the refrigerator one time. That's right. I saw it. Now, I didn't see one where you could take a piss and still watch the TV. That'd be neat. Wouldn't get no woman to live with you, though.
No, you'd live alone. You wouldn't be living alone.
Living alone anyhow.
There's nothing wrong with that. I'm good company.
Well, I kind of like him being the one that's a little bit more afraid of mortality. You're kind of a realist.
Afraid of death?
You're kind of a pragmatist, and you're not so sure what's gonna happen. You know, you're sure. You don't think anything's gonna happen. You think when you die, you're just gonna turn into dirt. And your character, you've got a lot of fear. You know, you don't know if you believe in heaven or hell or whatever. So I don't know. Uh-huh. And, you know, it's in your mind a lot. Maybe I like the fact that when you guys have recently been to a funeral.
What do you want, Christian bearer?
We've worked with some really weird sound men now.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, wow. And really good ones.
Names and names.
The best I've worked with.
I'd like to be a little closer, I think. Everybody settle and camera still rolling?
Yep.
Oh, whenever you feel it.
Be careful, there's a lot of rich people in the town now, you know?
I'm gonna have to get going. Love you too. Thanks for your tireless efforts.
Thanks for making a great movie.
Flow of the art. Did y'all watch the whole thing?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Did you?
Yeah.
Was just
getting a little tired of it, really. I wanna make our movie now. Alright guys. You better get going.
I'll talk to you, Dad.
All right.
I love you.
Bye, Renee.
Yeah.
As I walked out in the streets of Laredo, as I walked out in Laredo one day, I spied a young cowboy all wrapped in white linen, all wrapped in white linen, as cold as the clay. Well, I see by your outfit that you are a cowboy, this poor boy said as I boldly stepped by. Come sit down beside me and hear my sad story. I'm shot in the breast and I know I must die. 'Twas once in the saddle I used to go dashing. 'Twas once in the saddle I used to go brave. First to the alehouse and then down to Maisie's. I shot in the breast and I'm dying today. Get six hardy cowboys to carry my coffin. Get six dance hall ladies to bear up my pall. Throw dozens of roses all over my coffin. Roses to deaden the clods as they fall. Fetch me a cool taste of water. My lips, they are parched and I'm terrible dry. But before I could bring him that dipper of water, gone to the roundup, his spirit did fly. So I'll swing the rope slowly and play the fife slowly. Play the dead march as you carry him along. We all loved our cowboys, so brave, young and handsome. We all loved our cowboy, although he'd